I've compiled this because even though True to Our Roots is very much something that I'm pioneering I'm guiding everybody with, it's still important to have a little bit of structure and to realize that it's not just something that I've guessed, you know. It's been, True to Our Roots comes really, it's been growing as a result of years and years of soul searching for myself and the essence of Qigong. What is that really? And the essence of Qigong is self-healing. That's it, and it very much forms part of the Taoist philosophy, especially in traditional Chinese medicine, where in traditional Chinese medicine you have acupuncture, which is based on the meridian system, the meridians being the channels of energy. So like we've got our arteries and our veins, where you've got the exchange of blood flow. You know, we've got vessels and channels which are there for the flow of energy. And along these meridians, along these vessels, are lots of little points. So we are like a mini universe, if you like, yeah, with stars. But these stars are the acupoints that connect your internal energy system with your external world, with nature. So the whole point of Qigong is really about bringing your awareness to how you are not separate from nature. You're not separate from the universe. We're all just completely entwined, and we tend to forget about that. So I put together, first of all, what the full package is, what you get from True to Our Roots Qigong. And the first thing is, in a society where we're all chasing our own tails and all the time under pressure to achieve well financially, successfully, to be a good parent, to be a good business person, etc., etc., we get stressed, you know. And stress starts at an early age with children, because that stress is imposed upon children when they go to school. So, you know, they have to learn to achieve, even though they have all that freedom and the joy of wanting to play and everything. They are instantly introduced into a society of high tension and pressure, yeah, of high achieving. And very often parents do it as well, because maybe they are living their life through their children, you know, or they want, because they didn't get the opportunity, maybe they hope the children will get that opportunity. So there's always a good reason, and it's always one, but it's usually based on fear, yeah? So what I wanted to do was to bring our awareness back to our bodies. So from having been a fitness instructor, you would have thought that my awareness would have been a big one on my internal body, but it wasn't. It was on Body Beautiful. It was on creating a six-pack. It was on creating strong muscles. It was on creating a great appearance. And of course, the high that you get from that as well, you know, which is when you stimulate the endorphins and you stimulate the opiates. So if you know, I can quite frankly say that I became an opium addict, really, because I was addicted to the rush that I used to get from the really tough exercises that I did and I taught and shared with people. They were fun, it was a good time, but it still broke my body. I decided that as a result of my body breaking, I also brought in a Qigong. I started to learn to practice Qigong forms in 1990, and something led me to continue. Something, some force really guided me. It's the only way that I can explain, to keep at it, to stay disciplined. I never quite knew, and I was always in this duality where, you know, I was getting such a kick from Keep Fit, Western Keep Fit, but there was a part of the Qigong aspect that also was interesting. And in the Qigong that I was taught, there were two aspects. There was the active Qigong and there was the passive Qigong. And the active Qigong were the forms, the disciplines, the exercises. The passive Qigong was the meditation. And boy, did I not want to do the meditation. I found being still and listening to my breath and switching off thoughts, I found that like impossible. So from that place to today, you can imagine how much I've filled in and I've learned. You know, and through my own research, using my own body really, I have found hopefully ways that make it much more accessible to everybody to get into a meditative state without really trying. So when you get into your fluid system, that's, you know, it's instant. You get into a trance instantly, really. So I found as well that as a result of the wisdom of Qigong and the Taoist philosophy and which traditional Chinese medicine is based on, it goes back thousands of years. It's posture. We get so obsessed with what goes on in our head, we forget about our bodies. So I thought the first thing that it happened to me, because I ended up with two metal hips. So even though I thought I was standing upright and I was strong, I still ended up breaking my body and still ended up having to have two metal hips. So I really had to learn. So I would say that over the last 18 years have been a very, very powerful learning curve, and it's been tough. You know, I didn't have a near fatal car crash, but I had an ongoing, you know, it was just ongoing. And then during those 18 years, there was a lot going on at home. My parents died. You know, I was thinking, am I ever going to be able to walk properly? There was a lot of pain, and it was just like a never-ending search, you know. And I kept pulling myself up. I kept coming out and saying, come on, you know, I'll be all right. There was always one thing that kept me going. It was my hope that I knew I would be all right one day, that I would be well. So something was always, you know, something was actually guiding me to say, well, it's going to be all right. And it was that search. It was like, I need to get to that light there, but how to get to it, I didn't quite know. But somehow I did, and now I can honestly say, whew, that tunnel, I'm just leaving it now, and I'm out in the light, you know, and it's just beginning. But it's been hard, you know? And of course, emotionally, physically, everything. And it's a lonely journey. And that lonely journey has given me added strength in knowing that we actually are not alone. That there is a power, an energy that you can call angels, God, Allah, your guides, it really doesn't matter. There is a force, a supreme force, that when you tap into it, you get instant results. And that's the magic. And it's that faith that I've had that's kept me going. You know, and always a glimmer of hope here. And in fact, it's really interesting because I've got there's a Russian woman who saw some messages that I put on Anita Morjani's timeline, and she's Russian. And this morning she asked if she could be my friend on Facebook. And you know how you get a lot of people wanting to be your friend, you've got to be a bit dubious and stuff. And so I looked at her timeline, and for once it wasn't just a photo of somebody and the same photo of somebody and so on and so on. She actually had different things going on, and it was quite interesting. And very much along the lines of the articles that I've written in the last few months. So I actually befriended her, and I thought, you know, she sent me a private message, and she says, you know, Nadia is short for Nadezhda, and Nadezhda in Russian is hope. And I knew that. But I thought, you know, that message this morning was kind of symbolic for me, because to be told that, to be reminded, and she says, do you speak Russian in this lifetime? Well, I speak a little Russian because I did learn it years ago, but I don't speak it with anybody, so no, I don't. But so that was really nice. So hope is what really got me to where I am now. And I don't stop hoping, really, and also trust. So even if you have, you look in the mirror, you just see yourself, try to remember that, you know, you're not alone. And it's like, you know, when you're born, there is an energy that is born with you, and you just have to turn to that energy, tap into it, and ask for guidance, and you will get it. So that's the beauty. So along this last sort of 18 years, I can say that I've had to reorganize my entire posture. I've had to learn to walk again. I had my last hip done 7 years ago now, so unbelievable, in 2011. And the first one was in 2005, and I had to learn how to walk again, because how I walked before did not do me any good. And the other thing, of course, with Qigong, so along the forms that I learned that breath is used as a medicine, and you can use breathing in different ways. Now, in a stress society, our breathing becomes very, very shallow. It stops here, because we are actually in the state of fear. And you know, when you're afraid, your instant reflex would be, and then from that state, try to breathe. And your breath is just shallow. So how are you oxygenating your internal organs? They're getting some oxygen, but the circulation is not as good as it should be, and it becomes a bit more trapped. So I'm not talking in a scientific language, I'm talking in the way it feels to me. And so to me, it feels that if your blood is not oxygenated properly, it can't carry the oxygen efficiently to all your internal organs and your entire system. So it will focus on a place. And mainly that place will be your heart, yeah? Your heart and your lungs, for example. So if there's too much going on there, it cannot distribute it clearly. So breath is being used to alleviate the symptoms. So there is your fire breath and there is your yin breath, the yin being the soft way of breathing. There's different ways that you can use. So a long exhalation is expelling extra or excess fire from your heart, or excess, you know, heat from the body. But if you tend to have low blood pressure, for example, you want to then encourage the fire breath. So then you take a long inhalation and a short exhalation. So that's just to give you an example of how breath is used as medicine. It's really, you know, and if you need to gather instant chi, instant energy, you just do the belly breath or the bellow breath, you know, that one, where you can just regenerate energy very quickly. So you're going to learn to do all of that. And then, so we play with that energy, you'll become aware of the energy flow. And with that method, magic can happen, because if you learn how to do it, then you can help your children, your friends, or whatever. So this isn't a method that only me can do to you. This is something that I'm sharing and saying, you know, this is a human inheritance. Actually, this doesn't just belong to me. I am not a master, you know, and there's so many people who call themselves masters. I cannot be a master over you. This is about finding your own internal master, because there is no difference between you or me. Nobody is more superior or inferior. We're all the same. It's just that I've learned a bit more with regards to this, and I can share it with you. So rather than keeping it to myself, which is a complete waste of time, and you know, I want to share it. So it can help with your skeletal alignment, and of course then it will help with your internal alignment, visceral, etc. And you reconnect with your fluid system. And the fluids, can you mention some fluids in your body?
Blood,
yeah. Lymph, yes.
Saliva.
Urine. Yeah. Sweat. Mm-hmm. Tears. You know, there's a fluid between the joints. There's a very important fluid, the cerebrospinal fluid, that connects your brain all the way down your spine, you know, and it's like a semi-hydraulic pump, if you like. That's pumping that cerebrospinal fluid up and down. And then all the cushioning. And what we have been working with in spontaneous Qigong is to feel the fluid and the stretching when you start to move. And you can feel it. Well, now, you know, some of you will have heard that 2 weeks ago, the scientists have actually found that there is such an organ, which is, and they have given it the name of interstitium, and I got terribly excited because they had completely ignored this. You know, when they wanted, how they came upon it was when they were testing a patient for bile cancer or bile duct cancer, and so to get the cell to see to to examine the cell in the microscope, what they normally do is they drain the fluid so they can see what's going on with the connective tissue. So I always talk about when you stretch a connective tissue, a bit like a cat, a dog, or any animal does that. And it feels lovely because it's stretched from inside rather than an external stretch which causes a lot of energy and effort. And with the interstitium, they found that there is like this incredible, like a bubble wrap around everything. So each cell is bathed in fluid, and the fluid is like a layer under the skin and all of that. So when I say, when you get into that state where you are working with your fluid system and you let the chi move you, you get all juicy. You know, I always say you feel really juicy, and I never quite knew why or how, but that's how it felt. It lubricates your entire system. So it plumps the skin up, and it brings tears to your eyes, so it brings you spark again. It just makes you juicy. It's the only way you can describe it, because it stimulates all the fluids in the body, so it kind of lubricates you, yeah? Whereas fear and the not knowing how you are in your body and how you're moving causes rigidity. So when you have rigid areas in your body, what happens? The fluid's not flowing, you dry up. And you see these people aging, you know, and they age and they shrivel up and they lose their spark, so the spirit is sort of not quite embodied. And, you know, there is a lot that happens to ourselves. And if you think that we are, I mean, that's the other thing, you know, in this new alternative way of thinking, but I'm a great believer, that we are actually spiritual beings having a human experience. And I really strongly believe that. And so if we're here just for a temporary minute, you know, why not whoop it up? You know, why not just have fun and stop getting so uptight inside there? So that's the other thing. So the overall goals of True to Our Roots Qigong is to enhance your everyday life, yeah? And your activities. So it means that you can tackle things with more ease, less stress, you know, the body will feel calmer. So I find that I can do probably just as much as years ago, but with a lot more ease and calmness about it, rather than getting all stressed and uptight. So I used to get stressed and uptight and really cross because I had so much to fit in my day. Whereas now, okay, it gets done. And if it doesn't get done, then, you know, we had a conversation together, Carol and me, about, you know, when you get older, you don't do so much, you can't do so much. But I think also the aspect of that is that we become more sensible to what's important and what needs doing and what doesn't. And of course, when you have children, you're younger as well, and you have the energy to deal with the children. Good luck. But that's all part, and you're still young, so that's fine. You know, but the thing is, what I'm saying is that practicing Qigong on a daily basis, if you can, or regularly, will give you the added energy to deal with life in general. You know, whether it is a sports, or whether it is your work, or whether it's your children or your grandchildren or whatever. Yeah. So it also strengthens the body. You're much more agile. You become much more agile. It improves intelligence, and it prolongs your life. And it also manifests a latent power within all of us. And that is, for me, one of the most important things. We have deadened our senses, our natural senses. You think about, I mean, I've lived a big part of my life in Africa. Well, maybe not quite so big now as I'm getting older, but, you know, to me it's still a big part. It had a very strong impact. That the Maasai people, they are cattle herders. So they live out mainly in the Rift Valley, the ones that I'm talking about. They are tall and proud. They use their feet properly. they only eat as much as they need to because they use their cattle and they drink milk, all this kind of thing, you know. So you've got the Maasais, but they have rituals, and they, I'm not saying that all the rituals I agree with, but you know, what I'm saying is these are people who live close to nature. They live with the earth, so they follow the cycle of nature. You've got the Aboriginal people, you know. In fact, a lot of these people that the Brits and the other ex-colonials called barbarians were actually the civilized, cultivated people, because they knew how to deal with nature, and they understood that they were part of nature. They worked with respect, so if they killed an animal to eat, there was a ritual, there was a respect for each other's life. They had a natural, their natural senses were very sharp. So telepathy, you know, you could communicate with each other through telepathy. You know, you had your gut, your intuition really, really was strong. And that sense of intuition is something that we tend to avoid, or we fear, or we doubt. We keep doubting it, because in our day of advanced technology, we are all about computers, and our mind is like a computer. Everything starts here. This is your brain. This is the real brain. This is your gut. And this is where the gut instinct, as a mother especially, but that men also have it. You know, it's just that because we can bear children, this is an area that is very powerful. This is where our emotions come from. This is where you feel things. And when you start to feel things here, it goes up and it computes up here. And then the rational brain decides to cause or create a chemical or chemicals, which then are transferred back into the body. And then we react. We have, how we react is entirely individual, you know. So we either choose to make this a chemical laboratory that is going to cause us illness, angst or whatever, or we begin to just be still with this part of us, which was natural. You know, this is the part that we have learned to suppress. So a lot of the methods that I've come across now as a search for why did I end up with osteoarthritic hips? Why was it all here? What happened here? Huge things happen in this area. That's why I'm talking about it, because my body's taught me that what is the most, one of the most vital muscles that crosses over the hip socket, the psoas muscles. The psoas muscles are your fight, flight or freeze reflex muscle. It's the only muscle that actually doesn't have a fascia, you know, like that cling film that covers everything, yeah? It's the only one that relies on being juicy. And so that juiciness, if you think about everything I've said so far, if it starts to dry up, you know, that's how you see elderly people who walk around like that, because their core muscles, the psoas muscles, are drying up. And why? Because they're afraid. You know, they might not be able to pinpoint their fear, but their fear is one that belongs to our society. You only have to listen to the news. You only have to look at publicity, adverts. Everything is to brainwash us and believe that we need to be fearful. And so that's why, in a way, it's not always good to watch the news, because you can create your center of well-being where you are, and then that will spread. Yeah? So how you affect the rest of the world is by changing how you live your life. And this is what True to Our Roots is about as well, is begin to realize how powerful you are and how you can affect the rest of the world. You know, we say, how can I do it? It's only little me. But you can. You live by example. And by living by example, you become fearless. You know that you're doing your bit of good in your corner. And then whatever you can do, it will multiply. You start to touch other people. You know, it's catching. It's catching. And so that feeling grows. Does that make sense? So So, true to our roots is a lot of different things. It involves being completely true to yourself. So for that reason alone, I am still undergoing processes, and I suppose I will continue to do that till I peg it. Because, you know, how can I be perfect? You know, perfection will be when I'm dead, because we will go back to that center of perfection. We are here to have these experiences and to gain wisdom so that we can share it with the rest of the world. So what we do, we address this body. Qigong, qi is energy, gong is exercise or work. You are working to activate internal energy. Qi is the life force on which the physical body depends. It's everywhere. Qi or energy is everywhere. It is the life force. The Indians call it prana, the Japanese people call it ki. It's just everywhere. You know, without it, we're dead. So we have different types of energy, of course, but to get your energy, so if you think about a little lady here during some of your breaks, if you want to take a look, this actually emphasizes what I just said. The acupoints, the meridians run, as you can see, through the whole body. So if you want to take a closer look later, you can. I'm not going to ask you to remember the points or anything. But with Qigong, in the more advanced group, what we're doing now is repetitions of which are the yin channels and the yang channels, because everything is based on the principle of yin and yang. Yin and yang meaning that there's two polarities in this world. You can't have fire without water, you can't have daylight without nightlight, you can't have the moon. Is the yin aspect of the sun, that is yang. Yang is the masculine energy, yin is the feminine energy. So everything is based on harmonizing and keeping that balance, that harmony. And so that is again based on the Taoist philosophy. So the Taoist philosophy, Tao means walking a path of life from birth till death. And you do it to the best of your ability. That's what Taoism is. So I'm very much of a Taoist in that way, that it's a philosophy. You live your life to the best of your ability, helping others, and doing it with simplicity and doing the best you can. Yeah. So it is really simple.